Let us pray together. Almighty God, we know within our hearts that this is a tender and sensitive time. But how grateful we are that you came to us as one of us to show us that God is tender and sensitive, loves and cares for this family, and seeks to comfort them today and in the days to come. And that we know without a shadow of a doubt, that Randy is in your precious care and keeping. And may that comfort our hearts. Forgive us of our sins in the precious name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. I begin by speaking from my heart that which I know is in your heart, and that is our purposes in being here. We are here out of love and respect for Randy Driver and for you, his family, and for those of you friends who have gathered to be with him. I thank God that he has placed within our hearts love and care for one another, that when we hear of the needs of those we love, our heart's desire is to go to them and to be with them. And I know not only today and in the past couple of days, but in days past and in days to come, you will be there for them. And we thank God. We're here for another reason, and that is to reflect upon life and the blessings of life. And then we are here to reaffirm our faith in Jesus Christ and the hope that we have in him. It's always dangerous when a Baptist minister says, "My comments will be brief." I know you, he didn't believe it either. But I'm going to stick to what Phyllis has asked me to share, and then to take just an additional moment of that. To those of you that I've not had the opportunity to meet, I'm Bill Young and was pastor of Central Baptist Church 1977 to 1982. Just completed 21 years as pastor at First Baptist Blackshear and now at Sweat Memorial here in Waycross. My problem is I'm 120 years old and I can't keep a church to save my life, you know? But in 1977, going to Central Baptist Church here, one of the things that God led us to do in reaching people for Jesus Christ, and I believe it was a divine initiative, we developed an evangelism strategy where we called it evangelism growth groups. And we prayed for God to send forth laborers into the harvest. And instead of setting a particular night of visitation, which falls through very quickly, we ask people to pray for a time and a partner to go when it's convenient. And at the fullest part of that evangelism strategy, we had 28 teams out visiting, knocking on doors, 7 days a week, all different times of the day. Naturally, I was a member of one of those teams, and my partner then is here with me today, Dr. Porky Haynes, and we went out every Tuesday night knocking on doors. One fateful night in 1979, we went into Moy Mobile Home Park and knocked on the door of a mobile home and were welcomed in by Randy and Phyllis Driver. And I believe that y'all had not been married very long. And they had attended Central Baptist Church and filled out a card. You can't get anybody to fill out a card these days to save your life. They filled out a card, and Porky and I, we knocked on their door, and I cannot tell you the course of the conversation. knew absolutely not anything about this young couple before that evening, do not know how the course of the conversation went. I could only guess. But by the time we got to the end of that visit, all of us were on our knees before God. Hallelujah. And Randy gave his life to Jesus Christ. 1979, probably July or sometime like in the fall. Well, they came right on into Central Baptist Church and have been exceptional members ever since then, and taken leadership roles, and how I praise God for that. I left Central in 1982, and I was gone from this area for 17 years. I'm not from this area even. But in 1999, First Baptist Blackshear found me in Richmond, Virginia, and asked me to come as pastor, and I did. And a couple of years after getting settled into Blackshear, Central Baptist asked me to come over and preach homecoming in November. I don't know how the paths crossed, because my memory is fading me, but I see myself outside of that youth building over there, I think in line to go in, and this incredibly cute, vivacious, energetic, charismatic little girl, somehow our paths crossed, and we introduced ourselves, and you know who it was, Renee Driver. And she was just shy of her 16th birthday. And I'm going to tell you, the Holy Spirit overwhelmed me. And we're talking 20 years after we knocked on that door. And I know what I felt in my heart. Thank God, this little girl is being raised in faith in Jesus Christ. Because by His providence, we knocked on a door when a man was ready to give his life to Jesus. RJ came along after my ministry there, but it is obvious that he is an exceptionally fine young man. And these are beautiful, beautiful, beautiful families. I made a promise to Renee back then that I never followed up on, because she was about to get her driver's license, and I was so overwhelmed with her that I told her, I said, if your daddy doesn't buy you a car, I will. Thank God Randy did, you know. Because I had children of my own that I was buying cars for. But she just told me that she's due another car, so when we pray the benediction, I may slip out. I don't know. And then I had the pleasure of attending your wedding. And what a beautiful, beautiful occasion. Think about this. And we take no credit, and Dr. Haynes is here with me today. He is here with me. We take no credit whatsoever. This is all the work of the Holy Spirit. But that night was set in motion a new family, and the gospel spread to a second generation, and now there's a beautiful third generation being nurtured in the Lord. Amen. There's a third generation being nurtured in the Lord. James Dobson wrote in his book, Straight Talk to Men and Their Wives, that the most important part of a relay race is the passing of the baton. If the baton is dropped, the next runner in line has to stop, has to double back, has to pick up the baton, and by that has been passed, and most probably will lose the race. And he says that the priority of parents is to pass the baton of faith to their children. And I have no doubt that this precious young families will pass the baton to these children, and they will pass the baton. And whenever Jesus comes back, one visit, one night, one soul saved will be hundreds. as the generations go. I share with you one passage of Scripture and then a moment to be careful here. But one of the greatest plans of salvation in the Scriptures in Romans chapter 10, and if somebody here has never committed your life to Jesus Christ, this is what the Apostle Paul has to say. That if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. You will be saved. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the Scripture says, whoever believes on him will not be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. For the same Lord over all is rich to all who call upon him. And for whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. And if you have not called on the name of the Lord, I would pray that you would just simply within your heart say, Lord Jesus, I believe you're the Son of God, died on the cross for my sins, was raised from the dead, come into my life, forgive me of my sins. And you've heard it said on television many times, we believe if you prayed that prayer, you just got saved. Get in a Bible-believing church and serve the Lord. God bless. Thanks for letting two old boys in your home that night.
I am not a public speaker, but I just want to say a few words Everybody here that knows Randy knows he was an outdoors person. He loved to hunt and fish. He hunted in a club with us over in Grady County. That's 120 miles. He didn't get to come very often. But when he did, he left the house before daylight and came back after dark. He was in the woods all day, every day. One morning, he and I and RJ went hunting. Foggy, cool. I went down to the place, got in a climbing stand, climbed up, and RJ and Randy took RJ to the pecan stand. Well, I'm sitting there. Little smaller buck come along. I shot him. Got out, went and got my truck, drove down there where I was, loaded him up, and about the time I got him loaded, I heard boom. I said, whoa, Randy done got one. Then I heard boom. I said, whoa, did he miss? Boom. Went on up there, went out there where it was. He had three of them on the ground. We had a deer skinning good time. He also loved to fish. And I could tell you a bunch of fishing tales, but I'm only gonna pick out a couple. We fished the Sotilla a lot. And we also fished, he had a buddy now, I think his name was Phil, that had a place off to Alderman Hall, to Oak Muggy or somewhere, a cabin. And Randy and I used to go out there, and we called it the mudfish hole. You catch a bass every now and then, but you could catch plenty of mudfish. And we were fishing on there and catching mudfish. And Randy had when he fished back, that's when they had the handles on the reel. And he held the handle when he was fishing. I always held the palm of the reel, but he held the handle. Well, Randy had a brand new reel, first time he'd ever fished with it. He got a bite, and buddy, he set the hook, and that thing broke right below the reel, and it fell off in the water. And that was the most pitiful look I ever seen. He's sitting there watching bubbles come up. That's my new reel. That's my new reel. I said, don't worry about it, Randy. Boy, he turned around and looked at me. Woo! If looks could have killed, I'd have fell out of the boat right then. But and I'd had tied a treble hook and a piece of lead on, threw it, and the first cast, I brought his line up, had it hooked. I said, him, pull up your new reel, shut up. he pulled it right on up and put it on another rod and went to fishing with him. And if you knew Randy, you also knew he couldn't stand the sight of blood. Human blood. He could skin a deer, didn't bother him. And we were fishing over here at Jamestown on the Sotilla. I was fishing a bangalure, and I threw it and got it in a bush. And I give it a little pop to break it loose, and that thing come back like a rocket, and I did this, and it hit me in the back of the arm. Went in. I messed around there and pushed the barb through. I said, Randy, I can't see it to cut barb off. You're going to have to help me. I can't. I said, you want to fish any longer or you going to cut this barb off? I can't. Well, finally, I persuaded him. I got a cloth and got it wet and got all the blood off right quick. And he got there and cut it and sat down. And when I looked around, his face was whiter than Phyllis's hair. I mean, he was about to... I had to just let him recuperate a little bit, but we went on and caught some more fish. But I'm gonna let it go. I don't need to be too long-winded either. I loved him. He was technically my brother-in-law, but he was my brother.
Amen. Amen.
Oh, train coming down the line, feeding off the souls that are lost and crying. Rails of sin, only evil remains. Watch out, brother, for that long black train. Look to the heavens, you can look to the skies. You can find redemption staring back into your eyes. There is protection and there's peace the same. Burning your ticket for that long black train. Cause there's victory in the Lord, I say. Victory in the Lord. Cling to the Father and His holy name. And don't go riding on that long black train. There's an engineer on that long black train, making you wonder if the ride is worth the pain. He's just waiting on your heart to say, let me ride on that long black train. But you know there's victory in the Lord, I say. Victory. From a mile away, it sounds so good, but I must stay away. That train is a beauty, making everybody stare, but its only destination is the middle of nowhere. But you know there's victory in the Lord, I say. Victory. Devil's driving that long black train.
I shared with the family when I met with them earlier this week, and then when we gathered just a few minutes before the service, that when Christians gather for a funeral, our purpose is twofold. We want to remember the life that was lived, and we want even greater than that to celebrate the gospel of Jesus. The gospel changes everything about this moment. You know, there is something that is unique happening here that that the rest of the world does not enjoy. So grief and sadness from death is not unique to us. In fact, that has been a part of living on this earth since Adam and Eve walked out of the Garden of Eden. So every generation, every tribe, every nation, every people have known that the grief that you're experiencing today. But what is unique for us is that for those of you who know Jesus, there is hope. The Bible says that we're to be people that grieve even with hope. And that, dear friends, is I think probably a very strange reality for those who don't know the Lord, and yet most precious for those who do know the Lord. When we gather together in a moment like this and we're trying to celebrate a life lived, we often reach for stories. Roger, I appreciate those stories you told, because when we're trying to capture somebody's life, that's what we do. We reach for stories. And so we tell stories of like how a boy from Tifton and a girl from Cairo met right here in Waycross, and by God's providence met and married and had a wonderful 42 years of marriage, two kids and five grandkids, and blessed greatly. We tell the story of work and labor. And so, you know, Randy worked in an industry that worked with the security and banks, and it's amazing the stories that just naturally bubble up. Folks around town will talk about how in their work, a lot of times he was there before they could get to a project when something was broken, and he would be there long after to make sure things were working right and was hardworking and diligent. We talk about hobbies and things we love, so hunting or all the Pinewood Derby trophies on the wall and all the things. And we also tend to talk about how things begin and how things end. So I'm very thankful, Brother Bill, for you sharing the story of coming to Jesus, because that does change everything. But we also tend to tell the story of how we end. Now, I want to say something here, and I want you to hear me very carefully. Any death, no matter how it comes, is ugly. We were not created for death. Death is a consequence of the curse of sin. And when death comes, we have some strange words that we use about it. So if the Lord gives you many years on this life, in this world, and you die at an old age, we'll say stuff that goes, well, they had a good life. Yes, but they still died. And there's something ugly about that. If someone dies in their youth, we say it's so tragic that their life was cut short. If somebody dies tragically or suddenly, we talk about the shock of it. And then, of course, in Randy's situation, when there's been a long illness, we recognize the difficulty and the hardship that comes with a disease that is stealing from us the strength and vigor of our bodies and causing us to suffer. We tend to talk about life in the context of beginning and end. So I want to press to you this today, that for those of you who know Jesus, this is not the end of the story. In fact, the reality of it is, it's really just the beginning of the best part. Amen? When you put on the scale, on the spectrum of eternity, the Bible says that our life on this earth is like a mist, very, very short. When Randy believed on Jesus on the floor of that trailer park, he believed in what he knows in the fullness today. Believed in faith then in what he knows in the fullness today. And the testimony of the gospel is that through the work of Jesus on the cross, all, and I mean that in the fullest sense, all that the curse of sin has taken away from us, God is going to restore in the fullness. And so when the Bible gives glimpses into what glory will be like, it uses words to explain to us in hopes that we capture the sense of what it will be like to be in bodies and in a world that no longer knows the suffering of sin and death. I want to read to you a passage out of Revelation 21 that is giving us a glimpse into what life will be in the presence of the Lord. John writes this. It's the revelation that God gave John. And he said, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God.'" And here's where it gets good. Listen carefully. "And he will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning or crying, nor crying, nor pain anymore." And this is the best word of all. For the former things have passed away. Later in the passage, he says, and behold, I am making all things new. ALS is a terrible disease. It's terrible because it steals from you. It takes a healthy body, and it slowly takes away that ability for the muscles to work. And for the family, caring for Randy and watching that was hard and difficult. And it was a constant reminder of the curse of sin, that our bodies are not as they should be. Now, dear friends, the truth of it is all of us are living that to some degree. Some of you put in hearing aids today because you can't hear the way God wants you to hear. I put in my contacts this morning because I cannot see the way God intended for me to see. Some of you, your joints hurt. Some of you are hurting right now. All of those things are a testimony to our bodies are not as they were intended to be. Now, some suffer more than others, but all suffer. And here is the word of God. That is neither the intention of us, and neither is that the future of those who love the Lord. Here's the good word. In this world, everything that is corrupted, in the glory that is to come, everything that is corrupted by sin is passing away. There are some things that it is good and right to let go. And I'm going to tell you something, friends. Bodies that are under the curse of sin, it is good to let them go. There will be nobody, when they get their glorified body in heaven, will say, oh, I wish I could go back to the good old days when my knees hurt every morning. And nobody's going to say in their glorified bodies, oh, wasn't it wonderful when we could wear glasses and hearing aids and all the things that come along with bodies that are under the curse of sin. It is good to let those things go, and it is good to anticipate and long for the day when the Lord makes all things new. You know, we don't really know what the fullness of that means. We know what the word new means. I mean, you've experienced new things. You've had new cars and new homes and new things. But the reality is, in this side of heaven, on this side of heaven, the minute you get something new, it immediately begins to what? Deteriorate and become old. We can't keep anything new. We can't keep anything fresh because everything this side of heaven is deteriorating. But the word of God says, behold, I'm making all things new in a land where there is no crying and there are no tears and there is no weeping and there is no mourning because all those former things of the corrupted world under the consequence of sin will be no more because he has made all things new. Dear friends, that's a world and that's a place where there is no such thing as ALS. Or arthritis, or old age. There's no old age in heaven. Praise God. Because he's making all things new. I want to encourage you this afternoon that the promise of heaven and the hope of the gospel is not just a future by and by hope to be someday hope. I believe the hope of the gospel is a present hope. We are not to grow comfortable in our present brokenness. In fact, the suffering of this world, God uses it to push us to long for heaven all the more. The more you know the suffering of this world, the more you long for a day when bodies don't deteriorate and death comes no more. That is our present hope. Recognize in this present moment that the things of this world are only momentary. I don't know if you've ever been in a difficult situation, but when you are in a difficult situation, it is helpful to know how long that situation is going to last. You can watch the clock, you can mark the calendar, but if you know it's going to end, it helps to persevere in the present. And dear friends, I've got words for you. This present brokenness is coming to an end. And for those who know Jesus, we will rejoice indeed when it comes. And so for those of us who know the Lord, the calling for us is to live presently in our eternal hope. As bodies deteriorate, as minds grow dim, as ability leaves us, we are to live in the present hope that the Lord is going to make all things new. I have always had an affinity for the restoration of old things. I like old cars that have been restored. I really like old buildings that have been restored. The only thing about those things is, first of all, you have to be quite wealthy to do that because if you're going to restore an old car, you're going to continually restoring old cars. If you're going to fix up an old building, you're going to continually fix up old buildings. Because if you take something old and you put new paint and new hardware on it, what you have is still something that's really old, just with a fresh coat of paint on it. You haven't really made it new. You've just spruced up what was old, but it's still very much aged and all the consequences that come with that. When the Bible says that he's making all things new, the imagery there, the idea there, is not an old car with new paint. Neither is it an old house with a new roof. It is completely, totally new. Unstained, unmarred, unblemished by what came before. And dear friends, that is our hope. And that is what encourages us in this moment. For believers, there is something unique that happens when we bid farewell to a loved one. There is something joyful about that, particularly when we've known, when our loved one's known the reality of suffering. Because in death, there is healing for a believer. And so for Randy, we, even as we grieve, we rejoice that he has been and is and will forever be healed. And dear friends, that is a good word indeed. Let's pray together. Oh, Father, we love new things. New things give us a sense of freshness. They give us a sense of hope. And yet, Father, we live in a world that everything is deteriorating. Nothing remains new. And into that brokenness, into that reality, you speak these precious words. Behold, I am making all things new, for the former things have passed away. Father, our hearts grieve today for Phyllis and for Renee and for RJ and for the all of the family, Father. Our hearts grieve for them as we know their hearts are broken over missing Randy. Father, we grieve for Raylan and Carter and Maddie and Tripp and Helen and Agnes and Roger and Jeffrey and all the rest of the family, Father, that are grieving today. But we also, Father, are encouraged that there is hope here. There is healing here. There is the Word of God that sustains here. And so we pray for them as we pray for all who are here that loved Randy, who knew Randy, who cherished Randy. Father, that we would live presently in the hope of the gospel, rejoicing, Father, that you are making all things new, that the former things have passed away, and that your word is true and faithful to believe in. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen and amen.